Good evening and welcome to The Journey Home. My name is Marcus Grodi, your host for this program. This is the Open Line First Monday program in which we try to allow more of your phone calls and emails to ask questions to a returning guest. And I'm laughing because our guest tonight, he spends most of his ministry laughing and causing people to laugh, so it's very appropriate. Our guest tonight is a familiar person to many of you who watch EWTN, especially children's programming, because our guest is otherwise known as the Doughnut Man, but some of you don't know that the Doughnut Man's real name is Rob Evans. He's a former non-denominational lay minister, focusing mainly on children ministry. He's here joining us again with his story, but you're an absolutely essential part of tonight's program. So if you'd like to call us with a question, you can do so, 1-800-221-9460. Outside North America, you can give us a call at 205-271-2980. Or you can send us an email at journeyhome@ewtn.com. Rob, welcome back to The Journey Home.
Thanks, Marcus.
It's been fun spending time with you. Now,
it's good to hang out.
Journey Home is always a great excuse to get together with friends. And I'm anxious for you to tell the audience how your Doughnut Man, here's your favorite little guy here.
Here's my little buddy, Duncan.
Duncan.
Yes.
Here in the background.
My hat, my glasses. But as we agreed, we'll get to that.
That's right.
Later.
We'll get to that later. I'm just reminding the audience that we'll get to Duncan. And also talking about the significant differences as you've crossed the Tiber into the Catholic Church. But on the open line, I always ask the guest to give us a 5 or so minute summary of your journey.
Mm-hmm. My wife and I met as teenagers at a small house church in Medford, New Jersey. And it was love at first sight. We were married that year, and we had 5 children in 7 years, and we had a very similar background, raised in Protestant households, and went to Sunday school. I mean, my earliest memories are, here's the church, here's the steeple, open the door, see all the people, and that my Sunday school teacher smelled like rose talc, I remember. And I learned about Jesus in Sunday school. I went to Presbyterian and Baptist Sunday schools, and I loved to sing, and had a Victrola in my bedroom, and little boy Sambo, dressed in the prettiest clothes. And my father loved Frank Sinatra. Whoops, there goes another rubber tree plant. So I carried that, you know, that personality, I guess, you know, my aptitudes or my loves into everything I did. And as a new Christian and then as a new daddy, that was a natural way to express my faith to my kids. We would I worked as a carpenter, you know, so when you're 20 and your bride is 18 and a baby's on the way, and I dropped out of Rutgers University. I'm a child of the 70s and the 60s, and we would tuck them in. Daniel in the Lion's Den would be sung by the lion in my world. Roar, 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 I'm a big lion and I want to eat some more.
Did that put them to sleep or
no,
wake them up?
No, I would then eat them. It was great. And, you know, daddy playing monsters and stuff. Well, I would take typical daddy stuff and I would add Bible stories to them for the kids. And the mustard seed, I'm a little mustard seed, no hands or feet, and my face is green. And I would become the mustard seed, and my children would be gathered around me while I hear my wife cleaning up downstairs, and that's how we would tuck the kids in. So my wife and I were just delighted to meet each other in church and then be young parents. We had 5 kids, you know, while we were still in our 20s. And when you have 5 children, you don't get invited out to dinner very much. So is that a good summary?
That's your background. And then
yes.
You worked as we'll talk about the Doughnut Man later. Mm-hmm. That really became the focus of your life.
Well, I'm a repairman. Right. You know, I'm a donut repairman. So out on the job site, I'd have my hat and I'd eat donuts, you know, and then one day I got an idea of repairing donuts. I mean, I really am a repairman. Yeah. I'm a carpenter and a plumber. I had my plumbing license, and we were talking about plumbing, right? Mm-hmm. That children think that water comes out the tap, right? And you and I were talking about how it's important that children realize that the water comes from the ground and the tower and the pipes. And we were talking about the spiritual implications of how important it is that the children understand where living water comes from. Yeah. That was the segue. Yeah. So how can a plumber teach your child about Jesus? Well, if it's a spiritual plumber, then that's what the Catholic Church is all about. You know, that the pipes are connected, fresh water in, and flush the devil. Right? Confess your sins and the sewage goes away. So as a donut repairman and as a daddy and as a singer, I wanted my children to know Jesus in a personal way. And my wife did as well. She was delighted for me to spend daddy time, bedtime, tucking our kids in with various Bible stories and songs. And that's kind of the groundwork for the donut man. Mm-hmm. But we were both absolute Protestants. We would have nothing to do with the Catholic Church because we had both been taught Catholics don't read their Bible, they're idolatrous, Mary is the fourth person of the Trinity, you know, that Mary is way too elevated for our comfort. The Catholic Church is very pompous and arrogant with their robes and their incense and all of that stuff. And I'd even been taught that Thomas Aquinas was to blame for the Reformation, that the Reformers had no choice but to revolt against Thomas Aquinas's heresy. So there was a huge laundry list, Marcus, that the Lord had to work through for me to ever consider the Catholic Church.
How long were you active before you considered the Catholic Church in your full-time, basically full-time ministry?
I've been a full-time donut man for 25 years.
Wow. And pretty much seen the world doing that.
I have. I sang in Singapore, and I've been to England many times, and all over Canada, the United States. I have a platinum card from American Airlines. I've flown over 2 million miles as an evangelist.
If you look back, again, you were trained in many ways against the Catholic Church, given certain data.
Quite.
What would you say would be the number one barrier, the reason that all those years, the last thing that would ever cross your mind would have been to become Catholic?
We never checked it out. Shelley and I, my wife and I, never checked it out. I have one recollection of going to Mass, and I must have been a little boy. It was in Latin with the priest back to me, and it just made this permanent memory that Catholics are in gobbledygook. But as you got to remember, I was a child of the 60s. Have you heard that if you remember the 60s, you weren't there? Or it's we both had a lot of relearning to do. It was simple.
You
we
really
went
had,
to Mass.
You really had no reason to even consider the Catholic Church. You had no information that would have drawn you there. You had no experience there. So what would you say would be the number one reason, if there was one, that broke through that barrier that eventually opened both of you to the Church?
Well, the wheels came off of our Protestant experience. Over 30 years, we were members of about 8 different churches, and about half of them split. And it kept breaking our heart. Both of us are children of divorce. That is my wife and I. And it's a very painful thing as a child to go through divorce and to choose between your parents and to have your house split. It's a heartbreaking experience. And it's the best way that I can, it's the best analogy that I can make for how we felt when we went through a church split. It's like having your heart torn in two. So that's the ugly.
That's the negative side.
That's the ugly. The bad is we were badly taught about the Catholic Church. Right. And the good is that almost like a default. The very last thing that we would ever try would be to go to Mass, and we did. It's St. Francis Parish, Long Beach Island. We snuck in the back door a couple years ago, and we heard the Bible. Those Catholics, they read the Bible, and they don't hug statues. And then when it came to something we'd never realized, and it was Christ in the sacraments. Christ in the sacraments, the way the sacraments were handled, had an anointing. There was a profound peace and a love and a grace that was stunning to us. And I had the groom. How can I say it? I had the groom. I had Jesus. Protestants have Jesus. All Christians have Jesus. But do you have the bride, too? Do you have the church? If you claim you love Jesus, you have to also love what he loves. And it's the church. And he didn't just leave it up to happenstance. He gave keys to Peter. What does that mean? When he handed the Eucharist to the disciples, to Peter, in one moment in time, two sacraments were initiated right there. Eucharist, holy orders, boom.
Now, in case you want to hear more detailed description of Rob's journey, you can go find the Journey Home episode that you were on. You can do that at Religious Catalog, or you also have a website.
Late for Supper.
Lateforsupper.com?
Lateforsupper.com.
All right. Now, we're going to talk a little bit about this donut man business.
Yes.
And for those of you at home that aren't familiar with Rob's outreach to children, as a donut man, your program has been on EWTN for how many years?
10 years.
For 10 years, your mm-hmm. program, even before you were Catholic.
Before I was Catholic. Mother Angelica said he's Catholic, he just doesn't know it yet.
I love it. I love it. Well, we'd give you a little snippet of what are they going to see?
Why I'm the donut man, my little repair. Don't forget, I'm a donut repair man.
All right, let's look at this then.
Okay, everybody, back to the lodge for a big surprise. Oh, Matt, come here. You really gave us a scare back there. I'm glad you're okay.
Yeah, I guess I was pretty stupid.
Oh, don't you see, Matt? We really do need each other, no matter who we are. God wants us to take care of one another.
I'm sure glad Abby and Duncan cared about me.
Oh, we all care about you, and we'd be your friends if you'd just let us.
You mean you'll still be my buddy?
Sure I will, but even more than that, God wants to be your friend. He wants to fill your heart with joy. That's why we're called the Donut Repair Club. Look, see? Each one of us is just like a donut. We've got a big empty place inside that only God's love can fill. See?
See that? I think so.
Tell you what.
You know what's neat about that is, in many ways, your entire, how God opened the door for you to do so many things is because of one neat little illustration.
Isn't that something?
One simple illustration about the God-shaped void within us, that little simple illustration.
Well, you know, I steal from the best. St. Augustine, the God-shaped vacuum that only God can fill, that. And J.B. Phillips, the great Protestant Bible teacher, he used the same thing. Billy Graham,
Your goal was different for them because you had a certain audience you felt called to reach.
Yes.
Young hearts.
Yeah, young hearts. I wanted to reiterate, restate the treasures of the faith for young children. You go to Spain, you learn Spanish. You go to children, you need to learn childese. Mm-hmm. And so object lessons, are near and dear to the heart of the Catholic Church. You go through the front door, and there's a bowl of water right at a child's level. I love it. That was another thing that really spoke to me about becoming Catholic. It's color-coded, right? The priest wears red to remember a feast day of a martyr. You kneel, you stand, you call, you respond, you move, you line up with fellow penitents. We were ruined for anything less after we went to Mass. My wife and I were so moved by just a typical morning Mass, and everyone lined up for the Eucharist, and it was held with such veneration, you know, with such high regard. It wasn't just a casual serve yourself and think about Jesus kind of communion, mm-hmm. but the Eucharist is Christ. This is Jesus. This is my body. This is my blood. And it was so incarnational that it touched us. I like Catholicism because it presents the incarnation of Jesus. He becomes flesh, the maker of bread, the maker of wheat says, this is my body. The maker of grapes says, this is my blood. Mm-hmm. The maker of water says to the woman at the well, I'll give you water and you'll never thirst again. Mm-hmm. The creator of light says, I'm the light of the world. This is our incarnational theology. It'll rock your world.
Now, that little snippet gave in a nutshell that call that you experienced one day when you're looking at a doughnut and you thought about the image, and it led to the 25 years of ministry to children all mm-hmm. over the world. CDs, DVDs.
That's right, Marcus. Yeah,
that's right. There he is.
Is this an infomercial?
No. Because what I want to get to, it isn't, though, you know, I'm encouraging the audience to know more about what you do, but it isn't that, because you haven't finished doing that.
No.
You're still doing the Catholic. And
yes.
And the issue is, talk about the difference now. As you make the transition from a Protestant child evangelist, doughnut repairman, to a Catholic mm-hmm. child evangelist, doughnut repairman, what is significantly different in your message?
It now includes the way that the sacraments bring the love of Jesus into our lives. Holy water on my face reminds me of God's love and grace. This water helps me realize that I'm in Christ. I've been
baptized.
Yeah. Right?
Okay. And these are all songs you write.
Yeah.
That you write for the
children.
Yeah.
So in other words, my method really hasn't changed. I want to take a fresh look at stuff that has been covered with dust. Hmm. It started out in a vital way, and how can we blow the dust off of the treasures of the church for the next generation? In no way diluting the Eucharist or being a Eucharistic people. I'm not talking about a meltdown ecumenism, you know, a dilution
of the
faith.
Changing the truth.
No. But rather presenting the truths, the confession,
actually, no,
the reconciliation.
That is exactly what a man said around 1959, whose bust happens to be there, back there on the shelf, is Blessed John the 23rd.
John the 23rd, happy Pope.
But that was his goal behind the council, was not to change anything that we believe, but maybe examine the way we say it at times, mm-hmm. examine the way we present it. And in your particular case, it's how do we reach children? And talk a bit about, I mean, this importance of how do we reach our children. Mm-hmm. Talk for a second about what you do in all of your concerts. And I mm-hmm. happened to see one 2 weeks ago when you were in Columbus at St. Patrick's. And the importance of planting seeds mm-hmm. in the hearts and minds of our children. Mm. That they may not understand till years later, mm-hmm. but planting those seeds.
Thank God for Pope John the 23rd and the vision for Vatican II, because that seed that was sown in my heart bore fruit. It was years ago, what was that, 40-something years ago, that seed of Vatican II was sown in my heart. I didn't know it at the time. It was slumbering the whole time. But thank God that the church fathers said, we need to speak in the language of the people. I don't think I would have darkened the door of a Catholic church if it was in Latin. I now appreciate Tridentine right. Mass, don't get me wrong. Yeah. I love Latin Mass. But initially, I needed to hear the gospel presented in a Catholic church in my language. And then when it comes to talking to children, it's the same principle. Jesus said, if I be lifted up, I will draw men. I will draw all men unto me. I will make you a fisher of men. You're fishing for little guys, fishing for little men. How do you bait the hook? Here's a great example. My wife and I would take our kids to a restaurant and we'd feed them table food. But she had a little food grinder in her purse. And so we need to take the food of the church and just simply put it in the grinder and grind it up and feed it to our children in their language in a way that they can understand, because it's an outrageous faith that God made everything out of nothing, Marcus. How? Come on. How did God make everything out of nothing? Tick, 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 tick.
How? His word.
His word, the word of God. And then in Mass, why does the priest kind of lean over the cup and talk the word of God over the host? And the same creative word that created everything out of nothing is now transforming the elements, the host, into the body and blood of our Lord in the hands of his bride, in the hands of Peter, and a delegate of Peter. This is incredible stuff.
And part of your work is to, how do you help a young person understand that so they can appreciate it at their level?
I think you're the one who said the first thing, if you want to reach your kids, you need to get it. Yeah. The parent needs to realize how remarkable and outlandish and outrageous our faith really is. Virgin had a baby. go ahead.
Your ministry is to children.
Yes.
But as you look back over the years, to what extent do you think your ministry was also to those adults sitting in the background? Had come there for their kids but didn't realize they were going to get nailed themselves.
You have no idea how many parents came up to me. For years, I felt like a priest, because they'd say to me, you know, I came for my kids, but I like it. I really got a lot out of it. I really never saw that before. I call it, you know, backdoor evangelism, sandbox evangelization. You know, what? It's a wonderful thing about reaching the whole family. You know, I think there's a new terminology entering the Catholic Church. I've just heard it lately, and it's whole family catechesis, family faith formation. I'm very excited about for the church.
And I think it's a direct trajectory out of John Paul's call to a new evangelization.
Yes.
Which he meant as a re-evangelization of Catholics.
Uh-huh.
You know, we all need to grow in our faith.
It did not mean to throw out the wine and the bread and replace it with pretzels and Kool-Aid.
Right.
I've heard horror stories. I wasn't there, thank God.
We have a call. Let's take our first caller. This is Megan. Hello, Megan. Look, from Georgia. Are you there? Let's see if we can speak. Can you get her to speak up a little bit? Hello, Megan, are you there?
Yes, I am.
There you are, Megan. Hello, what's your question?
Well, it's not really a question. I'm just saying that this is a wonderful show, and I just love the Doughnut Man's show. I used to love it when I was a kid and all. Uh-huh. It was it's wonderful. I just love the show. It's awesome. I don't know. I'm just so into it. Well, whenever that little concert that he did on tour, I just loved it. I always stayed with it and all. It's awesome. I just love it.
Thank you, Megan.
Megan, thank you so much for that. That's great. We really do appreciate it. Let's take an email. We have an email from Bill from Missouri. Dear Marcus and Rob, God used the Journey Home program as an instrument in bringing me to the church. Since then, I've worked each year with our parish's RCIA team, and it seems that we constantly have larger classes year after year. Mm. How can you explain this amazing phenomenon, and how does it relate to your conversion? Thank you, Bill, for your own journey home. Mm. He's seeing an increase. Are you seeing that yourself?
For me personally, I'm not in that position. You are. You're seeing a remarkable wave of revival. Is that the right word? There's an influx of Protestants thirsting for more and not quite knowing what it is, and it can't possibly be Catholic. And then you sneak in the back door and suddenly you're met with the missing piece.
Well, actually, you're an example of what we see. For those of you that watch the program once in a while, I work with the Coming Home Network International. Our main apostolate helps Protestant ministers of all things come back to the church. Mm-hmm. And we hear from 2 to 5 brand new Protestant ministers every week. Sometimes year, 160 or so brand new ministers contact us. Mm-hmm. What's unique about what we see happening is, which I think is different over the last 25 years than what's happened all the way since the Reformation, is that we're seeing men and women, clergy and laity, professors, missionaries, looking at the Catholic Church, but they're not only from the usual suspects. They're not just Anglican, Episcopalian, Lutheran, maybe High Church Presbyterian. We're seeing Church of God, Assembly of Christ, Pentecostals, Disciples of Christ.
Jesus people.
Jesus people. Yeah. We're seeing, and they're not just coming in because they married into the church, but we're seeing authentic conversions to Jesus Christ and to the bride, the church, his spouse. That's what's unique. Mm-hmm. And I do believe that one of the main reasons for that is EWTN. I think that never before in the history of the world have more people been able to hear freely the fullness of the church through satellites, television, and
radio. May I do an infomercial on your behalf? Last year, you gave me a gift of Deep in History, your workshop, your conference on an explanation of the Reformation. Now, you've lived with this for 10 and 15 years, so you take it for granted. I'd never heard anything like it, about the Church of England and Calvin and the reason for the splits and how unreasonable they were. I had no idea how many reformers were in the Catholic Church reforming all along, but without revolt.
Yeah.
St. Francis was a reformer, for an example. Remarkable man, but he stayed in the church. You don't have to throw the baby out with the bathwater, right?
Well, and one thing the Catholic Church has always taught, and that is that renewal begins here. I mean, that's why the Catholic Church has been so committed to mystical theology from the beginning. In other words, growing closer to Jesus Christ in the sacraments, in the church, through prayer, through service, through sacrifice.
I doubt you. I think you're wrong.
Huh?
No, you're wrong.
Well, I'm doing the best.
No, I'm sorry. You know where I'm getting at?
You sound like this guy.
You're wrong. There's a critical spirit in Protestantism that I'm kind of alluding to, and it's loaded for bear.
Yeah.
And it's a fault-finding spirit, and it just kind of comes across like that.
Well-meaning, but blind to how that can be rooted in what happened 500 years ago. And automatically, because of the trajectory of things that happened 500 years ago or so, it has set people in a certain direction, which keeps them from even giving the Catholic Church a moment's notice, as you did for so many years in your own life.
Right. The protest is still alive and well in Protestantism. Far more Protestants derive their identity by being against Catholicism. Catholics are, according to Vatican II, separated brethren, a Eucharistic people. I just love seeing Christ in the Eucharist.
All right. We might have. Are we ready for this email yet? Looks like we're tweaking it here. Okay. This is a nice long email. I don't quite see who's on the bottom of the name of it yet, but we'll get to it. This is Jeanette. And she writes, "Dear Rob, I am a recent convert from the evangelical world also, and my question to you is this. Did you ever find it difficult to adjust culturally to the church with all its, quote, bells and whistles? I have found through my own experience that getting used to the form of Catholicism and the difference in the spiritual temperament of fellow longtime Catholics has been much more difficult than overcoming the liturgy ever was. Has this ever been your experience, and did you find that resources or ministries specifically designed to help converts adjust are greatly lacking at this time in the church?" God bless you, Jeanette. Thank you for your email.
Wow, very, very thoughtful. I made an allusion earlier, Marcus, to being a child of divorce. And if I could draw on that analogy again, when my parents divorced, I had to basically choose between my mother's household and my father's household. It was untenable. I shouldn't have to choose between my mom and my dad. And as a Protestant, I loved contemporary worship, for example. The words are on the overhead, and the drummer is drumming, and guitars are strumming, and people are clapping. And then, to be a Catholic, there is none of that, and you process, and you know, and you kneel, and you sing with solemnity. And unfortunately, at this point in history, you almost have to choose between the two. But my wife and I choose the solemnity, and we're open to
one thing that I was thinking about in relationship to something she said, and that is that making that transition into the, are there any resources? Forgive me, I don't want to be another infomercial for the Coming Home Network. I want you to check out chnetwork.org because our website, one of the things that we see is very important is that often, I've used this analogy before, that you and I could go through the steps to become a Frenchman, and let's say maybe in a year we could become a Frenchman. But it'd be many, many years before another Frenchman would ever mistake you and I for an authentic Frenchman.
Never.
Never.
Good analogy.
That's true about becoming Catholic. You can become a Catholic right away. You can learn, go through RCIA, but it's a journey. Mm-hmm. And some of it is even discovering the baggage. I mean, when you were the donut man for all those years, you're still the donut man, repairman. Mm-hmm. But wouldn't you say that before your main emphasis was on Jesus and me?
Right.
And now you have a big emphasis on the church.
Yeah.
Also.
Well, I would like to say hi to everyone at St. Margaret's in Narberth, Pennsylvania, and Father Chapman, and God bless you, Father Doherty, get well, and Sister Anne Marie, and these folks are really helping me. I've only gone to a handful of confessions, and Father Chapman is, come on, pitch it in here. You know, he's helping me, and Father Doherty lets me chew his ear off after Mass, and ask him questions. Exactly, Marcus. It's not a lone ranger anymore.
It takes a while. It's like that prayer, you know, I believe, now help my unbelief. It takes a while. Mm-hmm. Issues like baptism. You and I were talking earlier that for so long we always saw baptism, just one of the things, but you didn't need it. Mm-hmm. I mean, you could believe in Jesus and be saved, and whether you're baptized or not. That was a big part of Protestantism, mainly.
Yes.
But now we recognize, no, that it was the intended door to the church.
Yes, yes, yes.
Into salvation through the sacraments. And it takes a while to appreciate that. When you're looking at it still from a Protestant perspective, it's hard to understand that.
Now,
it takes a while.
Who just sent us the email? Was it Jennifer?
Jeanette, I think.
Jeanette. One more thought for Jeanette. Lay it on the table. Just lay it out before Father, before the priest, before your pastor. You should be able to not, you know, hide how different you feel. You know, if you're feeling like you're the fifth wheel, take it to the church.
Talk about it.
Yeah, take it to the church. You know, I'm not knitting in here. I kind of miss a Bible study. And there's, in a good, healthy Catholic community, there's all sorts of stuff that'll integrate you where you don't feel like such an odd man out.
All right, let's take a break. We've got some emails waiting. We'll be back in just a moment with your questions. Welcome back to The Journey Home. I'm here with the donut repairman and his little friend Duncan. And Duncan wanted to make sure I remembered to tell you that that his videos are available at EWTN Religious Catalog. So, and if you're interested more in finding out about the Donut Man, his concerts, and materials, you can go to donutman.com, right?
That's right.
That's right. And then again, your
email is donutman.
Very good. Send him an email. Mm-hmm. Any questions about what he does, especially if you... Any of you watch, especially those of you who aren't Catholic, remember seeing the Donut Man somewhere, got questions about his journey, email him, talk to him. He's very committed to Christ and his church and helping you understand the fullness of his journey, which is so hard to cover in one program. We have an email from Bill from Wisconsin. If a Catholic attends a Protestant service, he or she is welcome to communion as a baptized Christian. The Protestant is not at a Catholic Mass. Do you see this as an obstacle to Christian unity? Further, would you agree there is a difference between hearing Scripture at the Mass and reading it oneself? God bless. Thank you, Bill, for your email.
Wow.
Good question.
Yes. Two different paradigms. The Protestant communion is that. It's welcome to the table. And that is absolutely one aspect of Catholic communion as well. It's a family gathering. But it's more than that in a Catholic Mass. It is the body and blood of Christ. And it is a sacrifice presented by his priesthood. And for you to receive that communion without being in communion with that premise, then you should not receive it, because you're not in agreement. You're not saying yes to this is Christ. And as soon as the Catholic Church relinquishes the Eucharist in the name of, what did he say, ecumenism? In the name of unity. The name of unity, the Eucharist is no longer the Eucharist. And that's why.
And it's false unity.
It's false unity.
That's false unity. I remember looking back when I was a Presbyterian pastor, we would celebrate Lord's Supper once a month, and it was an open table. And I would say that from the pulpit. And as far as children, I left it up to the parents to decide. But I doubt, other than younger, really younger children, whether anyone abstained. Everyone in the church who was there, I'm sure, would take it. The little chunk of bread that came on a plate and the little shot glass full of juice that came by, and you know, that everyone would take it. In the Catholic Church, which is actually the case, is that it isn't just Protestants who shouldn't receive it, because that would be false unity, but there are Catholics that should choose not to receive it, because this is serious. It's not symbolic. It's not really an entrance into unity. This is the body and blood of Christ. And as Paul said in 1 Corinthians 11, the danger of not recognizing that it's the body and blood of Christ. He talks about that.
Becoming sick, and some of you die.
This is serious stuff.
Yes.
So when we Catholics are in sin, we should not receive.
That's right.
And sadly, sometimes we just receive it.
Right.
And we should not. It's a seriousness that it's a both and. It isn't just for everybody, and even sometimes it isn't for us. If we have not gone to the confessional, if we've not experienced the graces of the sacrament, so that we're appropriately ready to receive Christ.
The remarkable thing is that it's not a discipline that is from without, but it's a discipline that's from within. That when you walk in that, there's a richness. It's not like a police state. There's a richness as Christ reveals himself to you in your heart of hearts, and you actually receive the grace that comes from the Eucharist. It's incredible.
All right, we have a call from Mary from Ohio. Hello, Mary, what's your question?
Hey, Marcus and Rob. Yep. Thank you for taking my call.
Sure.
Well, the first time I saw Rob on your show, I walked into the room and I said, "Praise be to Jesus Christ, the donut man's Catholic," and I just had to say it again. Marcus, we had Alice von Hildebrand come to our school as a fundraiser, and she said to us, "Never be afraid to teach the little ones the truth, because they'll get it." Mm-hmm. And Rob, I really admire you for continuing that on, because they really will get it, and it's so important to get them when they're young.
Thanks,
so, man. Sorry, I'm pontificating, but my questions for you are, number one, is your ministry still going strong? I hope that it is. I hope as a Catholic you are welcomed into many parishes, and I would recommend his tape highly for all of you out there to buy. My kids grew up watching you, and you are a joy. Secondly, was it really just the split in the Protestant churches that you were with that called you to your local St. Francis of Assisi Church, or was there something, did I miss something? Was there something else that led you in that door?
Well,
thank you, Mary.
There's the good, the bad, and the ugly, Mary. The ugly was that we really did come to an end of our Protestant journey. The wheels came off. The bad is we were badly taught about the Catholic Church. We were fed erroneous information, but that came from outside of the Catholic Church. And then when we started to attend simple daily Mass, the liturgical calendar, hearing the Word of God and seeing the Eucharist presented in a righteous way, it simply brought grace into our lives that was remarkable. Was God's hand in it? Yes. Were we up a creek without a paddle? Yes. Did God close every other door and just leave that one? Yes. Why? I don't know. But I'm glad He did. And then the second question about my ministry, I just came back from a week on the road to celebrate Catholic Schools Week. And I was in Columbus and then on to Chicago. I went up to Fargo. Who have I left out? Ohio, Chicago, and I was in the Upper Peninsula of Michigan.
Oh, yeah, Marquette.
I was up in Marquette with the Yuppies. it's wonderful to travel around and be a Catholic doughnut, man. It's the thrill of my life.
All right. Let's take our next email. Susie from Nebraska. Dear Marcus and Mr. Evans, I have a friend who wrote me an email and wrote this statement, quote, "No one denomination has all the truth. Even if one started out with it, our humanness has made some serious untruth adjustments. How should I respond to this?" Thank you, Susie, for that easy email for our friend Rob Evans.
Oh, yes. I would say that the Mass isn't about heaven. It is heaven. Isn't that what our friend Scott Hahn says?
Yeah.
To look into the book of Revelation is to see the Mass. I say you don't even take that kind of email on its terms, but rather lift up your eyes and see heaven in the Catholic Church. Read your Bible, read the book of Revelation, see how marvelous it is, and let the dead bury the dead. You know, put your hand to the plow, look ahead, don't look back.
I'm going to add to that, because I'm going to say something bold that I might infuriate a few Protestant viewers, because I was there. Because actually I believe that person's quote and his view on truth, because basically what he's saying is ultimately truth is relative. That there may have been a truth, but humanness has so messed it up that now it's relative.
Hmm.
Okay? And I believe that that is the trajectory of Protestantism. I believe that that's true. If you look at historically all the splits, mm-hmm. you take any one, you follow it, it invariably leads to liberalism.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it very led to Unitarianism. It's going to go there because you're throwing away the bride of Christ. Mm-hmm. As the authority to be able to say, what is it Jesus said would happen to the bride of Christ? He said, on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. So what he's saying is that he established a church and that it was protected by grace. He promised the apostles in the upper room, John chapters 14, 15, and 16, that he would give them the Holy Spirit to guide them into truth, to help them remember what was true, to preserve the truth, to protect the truth.
Mm-hmm.
The Spirit has been given. Mm-hmm. He said, lo, I am with you always. He said that this church would be protected mm-hmm. so that we could see a truth. If you throw out the church, you eventually throw away truth.
Mm-hmm.
You can't just say, I've got the Bible, and the Bible is the sole foundation, I've got it. Because you're going to end up with this, your translation or my translation, your interpretation, my interpretation, mm-hmm. which verse over this verse, which important, you know what I'm saying?
Wait, sound the highest clowning cymbal. No, be still and know that I'm God. You have the cymbal or cymbal clangers, and you have the be still people, you know.
fighting it out, right? Yeah, so
uh-huh.
when you throw out the church and trust the church and the authority of the church established by Christ, what that gentleman said in his email is the trajectory.
Mm-hmm. You know what might also be helpful? That is for them to get a little synopsis of what Vatican II was all about. As you said, last time we got together down here, you said Vatican II was the first council that was not counter-reformative. What does that mean?
Did I say that?
No. Yes. Yeah, you remember it. You're pulling my leg. It was the first council that was not counter-reformative. It was proactive, I think you said.
Yeah. Well, again, it wasn't trying to redefine or to correct a teaching. It was looking at the world has changed so much.
How
can we reach out to the world?
How can we be better Catholics? Yeah. It was the
Catholic
Church,
wasn't changing
the
truth. The truth hasn't changed in 2,000 years.
There's a lot of Protestants that don't understand what Vatican II is. Yeah. There's a lot of Catholics that don't know what Vatican II is.
And it's a blessed council that is still blessing us in many ways.
Well, I'm
if you're not sure, you go to Tuesday night when Father Pacwa goes through John Paul's teachings and you see the carrying out of Vatican II through the teaching of Pope John Paul II.
I wouldn't be here without Vatican II.
Let's take our next caller, Linda from New York. Hello, Linda. What's your question?
Hi, hi, Marcus and Rob. What a delightful show. I love Rob. He is so creative.
Oh.
Now, this is my question, Rob. I taught confirmation for 5 years and love teaching confirmation. And I went through basically a life in the spirit with all of my kids that I taught confirmation to. And I would love to know how to incorporate some of your creativity into the confirmation process.
Mm. Well, they had to wait for the Lord to send his spirit. They had to wait. It's Pentecost, the story of Pentecost. So we've...
He's talking about different issues. It's kind of funny. I mean, I agree, but...
But confirmation is 8 years old? Is that right, Linda?
Well, it depends.
Okay.
It depends where they are, and with teenagers.
All right. Okay, but I'm talking about 8 to 10, right?
Yeah.
But it's the fruit of the Spirit. It's the life in the Spirit, the story of Pentecost.
Yeah.
Do you have the fruit of the Spirit? If you do, then aren't you glad? you do, the sower went out to sow, to plant some seed in hopes that they would grow. If you plant an apple seed, you'll grow apples. If you plant a seed of joy, you'll grow joy. So the whole thing of fruitfulness, the fruit of the Spirit, from a donut man perspective, that's what my songs are all about. And, you know, I'll give you a half hour to teach the sower. Give me 3 minutes. With a song, call and response, hand motions, just to get back to my angle, and that is to use the imagination of a child.
In fact, do real quickly, you've got the new song on the Eucharist.
Yes.
Give an example from your song on the Eucharist. To children, teaching young children the appreciation of the Eucharist.
The sun shines down and the wheat grows up, then we chop it and we crush it. We bake it into bread. The sun shines down and the grapes grow up. Then we chop it, we crush it, we pour it out as wine. We celebrate the Eucharist, though bread and wine we see. The priest, right? The bread and wine we see. The body and blood of Jesus Christ is hidden in these things, is given in these things. Yes,
I mean, so there, the children learn a song they can remember and then can
hand
build
motions, the wheat and the grapes, and they're tortured, and you know the grapes are tortured.
And it's
Jesus
neat when I was there and saw the concert, and all the kids were doing the symbols, and the kids up front and doing.
I wrote it a year ago, but we finally have. You know, I'm building my studio, and we had to move. We had an emergency move about a year ago for family reasons, but Doughnut Labs is on the march.
Take another email, Lynn. Writes, hi Marcus, my question is for the Doughnut Man. How did your ministry evolve? How did the Lord lead you from teaching your kids to reaching international audience? I am asking because I have a music ministry that I have started, and I would like to know how to meet and reach audiences for Christ. Thank you, Lynn.
Hmm.
And that's a good point. A lot of people, they've got gifts like you have up there telling stories of their kids in the bedroom.
Yeah. You just need to be faithful at each level and be ready to spend a little bit of money. Not a lot of money, but be ready to spend a little bit of money, of your own money, at each level. So I was tucking the kids in with Bible story songs, and my wife woke me up one night. She was crying. I said, what? She said, I think the Lord wants me to give you our vacation money. Vacation money, I said. How much? She said, $1,250. She'd been saving out of our food budget, and as I thought back, it made sense. That's where she got the money, out of our food budget. And so I made a tape of Doughnut Man songs, and for the local church, it was $1,200. And now here we are, a couple $1 million into tapes and videos and all of that. But it just starts at a local level, And now with computers and CD burning and be it DVD or CD, there's really no reason why you can't produce your ideas at a local level and just try it out.
Yeah. I would encourage the importance of spiritual direction for anyone that's wanting to do it. Other people help them discern really
good
if
point.
They have a call.
Yeah, yeah, very good point. Yeah, I'm begging.
You weren't completely alone in
not
the issue at others
no,
that
no,
were
no, no, no.
encouraging you and confirming your gifts.
Yes, and Sister Anne Marie at our church has put me in touch with a school just down the street from me, and they're autistic children and mentally challenged children, and I'm going to do a concert sometime in February, just to exercise that muscle.
Yeah.
Because I want to reach mentally challenged children, but I don't quite know how to do it, so I'm doing it for free. You know, I just want to exercise that muscle. So.
All right. Another caller, Mark from Ohio. Hello, Mark. What's your question?
Yes, my question is, I was also involved in youth ministry in the Pentecostal tradition, and how can I bring my gifts into the Catholic Church, but keep in line with the teaching of the Church?
Gotcha. And, all right.
Good
Making
question.
The transition. There's. The...
Yeah. I you know, I...
Especially the Pentecostal background.
Yeah. Hallelujah. welcome home, brother. You want to be catechized. Garbage in, garbage out. And it's not sola scriptura, it's not sola fide anymore. You want to be part of your church family. You want to really get into the rhythm, the beauty of Catholic liturgy and the church. And hey, Lent is Wednesday, right? what are you going to give up for Lent, right? I want to learn how to be a Catholic. And so you need to take your time before you can really be effective sharing the faith. You need to really become Catholic and then become an assistant in with our DREs and catechists and stuff like that. You need to pay your dues, and then your gifts will emerge. But you need to do it with a team. You don't want to be a soloist again. You don't want to be a lone ranger. If you want to have a Catholic message, you have to be Catholic. You want to be part of a family, part of a team.
Yeah, and it takes a while.
Yeah, you have
it really
to just let it.
Because if you try and do it too early, you might in a way be faking it because you kind of know it, what's true, so you're just passing it along, but it may not have made that journey from head to heart yet.
What's the thing in Latin, do no harm?
Oh, I don't know.
I don't know. Some it's in Latin there. Don't hurt nobody. Right?
That's right. I think that was the rabbit in Bambi that says, you remember that? Right? It was something like, if you don't have something good to say about somebody, don't say
it. Yeah, don't
at
say
all.
It at all.
Don't say it at all. Mm-hmm. Final words to the folk at home. Let's say there's somebody watching that right now is where you were.
Mm.
What do you want to say to them? Why should they come home?
Mm. I would say, it's a wonderful family, and it's a forever family. It's not just the Catholic Church here on earth, but you can spend time with Abraham, with Mother Mary. You got a mom in heaven, and she's not limited by time and space. And get to know the family. Spend time with Father Joseph. When I came into the church a year ago Easter, received my first Eucharist, I was told that I could take a new name. And I took Joseph because he's the saint of unrequited love. He doesn't say one word. And I'm real talkative. You know what I mean? I'm real talkative. And here's somebody who just does his job. He's just quiet. It's nice to be able to ask Joseph to pray for me. And so I'm running out of time here, Marcus. I love the communion of the saints. And so when I receive Eucharist and we spend time with our brothers and sisters in heaven, their virtue becomes our virtue. They're tuned to A440, my fellow musician. Tune me up, Lord. Tune me up, Holy Spirit. Tune me up, my brothers and sisters in heaven. and on earth.
Rob.
Yes.
It's been a pleasure. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Marcus.
Ask God's blessing on your continued ministry.
Thanks, my friend.
And again, doughnutman.com and latetosupper.com.
Late
for supper. Good. Thank you for joining us on the journey home. I pray that this has been an encouragement to you. And as I close, I'm going to ask a good friend to say good night. Duncan, say good night to the people at home. Good night. See you next week. God bless.